it's fantastic. I need to come back here more often.
They dig your stuff. They dig your movement. Thank you. When you come to events like this, and you start to see the adoration for a specific film, does it take you back to that time? What goes through your mind? Because we know what's going through all their minds.
I feel unbelievably grateful. I call, you know, mostly it's the Princess Bride. Generational thing. I meet folks who, at my age, I meet the next generation, the little kids who come up who've seen it, and folks who kept their VHS. How many people still have VHS? It's amazing. The keepsakes, people holding on to this movie is extraordinary. So I feel very blessed. Yeah.
It's pretty fascinating in the sense that. You know, you talk about movies that have cult followings, but the idea that this movie resonates with people. I was talking to fans, that were online, and they're reciting lines from the movie. Are there any lines that people ask you to recite?
Oh my gosh.
There's one. You're going them all, ladies.
As you wish, yes.
Some guy from Sony said that there were always discussions about remaking The Princess Bride. And that dad followed you on Twitter.
Yes, I think there was talk about doing a remake, and I wrote, there's a shortage of perfect movies in the world. One of the big scenes I do is a big fair where the mayor greets And so we had a real fair. They built a real fair for us, and they brought all the great rides from all over the state and even out of state. And the Duffers said to me at one point, they're like, well, you have to break between, we have to shoot a bunch of shots without you. If you want, you can go on the rides. Thinking, this is a great gig, my God. How many places where you work where they say, hey, why don't you go on a few rides, and then we'll work with you later? And I'm like, okay, sure. And they said, well, there's one ride we really need you to check out for us. And I said, what's that? And they said, it's over there. And they pointed to this thing. I'd never been on this ride before. And you guys know what a salt and pepper shaker is?
Yeah.
That's not cool. Not cool. And I had no idea. And I got in there with the head of the makeup department. And she said, oh, this is fun. Don't worry, it'll be fine. I'm like, okay, sure. Get in this thing. Now, for those of you who don't know what a salt and pepper shaker is, Google it. But do not try it. This thing looks like two giant pills on the end of two poles, and it spins like a submarine that way as it's going round and round. So it's like being in a washing machine, basically. But you're not getting clean. You're getting very dirty. And I'll tell you something. I was essentially about to throw up on myself. And God bless the hair and makeup lady. She's like, you can't do this. First of all, you can't throw up on me. But you still have to shoot a scene. I'm in full costume and everything. And I thought, as they're slowing down, I'm thinking, thank God I didn't. She tore me off a ledge and I didn't throw up. And the thing starts to slow down and it comes down to the bottom and I'm thinking, we're done. And the ride operator goes, here we go. And starts spinning the other way. Now I'm spinning in the opposite direction, and this thing, and man, I gotta tell you, I had to shoot a scene later that day. As I got out of it, the Duffer Brothers were there with their cameras. I literally got on my knees and pissed the ground. And I will never get on that ride again. I've been there, done that, got the t-shirt, thank you. But they thought that was very fun. Not cool.
Well, it was very great to see you in Stranger Things.
Thank you.
And there's something that just came out. Yes.
Maisel!
You're Mrs. Maisel!
I know, I had an amazing year, very blessed. A wonderful, another wonderful show. Very funny. And I play Gavin Hall, who's egotistical British actor. It was a real stretch for me. And he's a theater actor. And if you haven't seen the show, it's a very funny show, very well written. And I play an actor who works with Jane Lynch in a play together. And we had a lot of fun. My gosh, we were laughing so hard. It's not like work at all. Sometimes when you go to work and having that much fun, it's like, this is great. They're paying me to have this much fun. Just silly.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's great. All right. I got two or three questions about Princess Bride, and then we'll get to your questions. I see there, you found the microphones. We're good to go.
Yes.
We're all set. All right, good. It's not really a question, it's more like a name.
Okay.
Andre the Giant.
Yeah.
Tell me about.
Oh my gosh, Andre. Well, he was a legend. I mean, there will never be another Andre. You know, right? One of a kind. 7'4" and 450 pounds of pure love. Really, just a lovely, gentle giant. Yeah, I would say he would give you the shirt off his back. It'd be enough for 10 people. And he'd give it to you. And that's who he was. And I'll never forget the first day we started working together. The first scene we had to shoot together was when myself and Mandy and Andre are going to storm the castle. And we're on the parapet about to storm Throne Castle, right? And I'm mostly dead at that point. I came up with this whole body thing where my head was flopping, which Rob really liked. And Rob, writer, the director, likes to shoot the rehearsals. He's like, why don't we just put one in the can and see how it looks? See, that's what he would say. And so Andre and Mandy had the dialogue, physics and
Fezzik, you guys probably know the dial better than me. And I think Fezzik says, I wonder how long before he thinks of that, about the miracle pill, right? And Montoya says, your guess is as good as mine. And then I come to and I say, I'll fight you both together, or beat you both apart. Like that. So, yeah. Thank you. I knew someone would do correct. And then Fezzik says, I guess it was very long about the pill. Well, he got to the word long and he let out the most magnificent fart. No, really, no. We've all accused each other of giant farts. This was a giant's fart, people. The decibel level of which I cannot begin to describe. Most of us still have tinnitus from that. By the way, somebody timed it. It was 16 seconds, which is actually a long time. And it had it flow. It had different sounds. It started really loud at the bass. Then it became like a little trumpet. And then it was it went up. Then it was a little tiny. And then it got loud again. And it seemed to go on forever. And this plywood set they put was shaking. Everything was shaking. I looked over at the sound guy and he lifted the headsets to protect his ear. And people were holding on to the set. It was like an earthquake. And when it was done, there was absolute silence. I mean, no birds, nothing. For miles around. They're not like here, where, guys say, oh, take it outside or whatever. But in England, they get very weird. Like, oh, is that a storm coming in? They get very weird. It was about a dog. It's a dog. But at this point, it was so loud and so long and so intense that people didn't know what to say. What do you say to that 16 minutes of something you can hear in Beijing? And when it was over, it was a good stunned half a minute silence, and then Rob Reiner broke the silence. The director, and he goes, hey, Andre. You okay? And Andre, without missing a beat, says, I am now, boss. First day. First take. The rehearsal. And of course, there was no, every time we got to the word long, we were all crushing ourselves. No, because it really was long. Right. I found out later from Hulk Hogan that was how he broke the ice, by breaking wind. And he sure did. I mean, after that, he got a smile out of everybody. Incredible. Yeah. My gosh.
All right. Andre the Giant's the biggest guy on the set. Yes. What about one of the smallest? What about Wally Schoen?
Wally. How great is Wally? Wally was one of my favorite people. Well, I loved all the actors on the show. And by the way, I grew up watching movies, so I knew all these people. I knew Chris Sarandon from all his work. I knew Billy Crystal from Soap and Saturday Night Live. You guys remember Soap? Yeah. I knew Chris Guest from Saturday Night Live. I knew Wally Schoen from a wonderful film he did called My Dinner with Andre. And he's a very smart guy. He's a Rhodes Scholar, and he speaks Latin and Greek. He could read Greek, okay, ancient Greek. Not just any Greek, ancient Greek. So when he says that line, Aristotle, Socrates, moron, you believe it. And I think that's part of why Rob cast him, because he is so smart, and he's a playwright, author, and really intelligent. And he was sweating, right? We had this one scene with him, which is the Battle of Wits scene. The American powder, and I get there to shoot the scene with him, and I have a very easy piece of dialogue. I think I just nod and say a word and then pass, or things like that. And he's got a long speech about never getting involved in the Vietnam War, but he's sweating, and the makeup people are coming in and dabbing him between takes, and I'm thinking to myself, why is this man the smartest guy in the room. Why is he sweating over this? This is a nothing scene for him. And it turns out he came up to Chris Guest after the first day, and he goes, you know, my bags are still packed. I'm ready to go home. And Chris Guest goes, what are you talking about? Well, I understand that I'm not the first choice for this role. Turns out his agent had told him that he was standing in for Danny DeVito. I know, right? And the poor guy was convinced that he was literally only there temporarily, as Rossini, waiting for Danny DeVito to show up. And he went up to Rob Reiner and he said, why you can't be in this role? I mean, I'm not even for Philly, I'm a Jew from New York, why? And Rob says, because you're funny. When you yell, your whole face goes red, it's funny. And to this day, I think he doesn't get how great he is in the role. I mean, if you think about it, I mean, Danny DeVito, a nice guy, talented guy, but it's inconceivable, right? It's all about role. But be warned, if you walk up to him and ask him to say that word, don't be disappointed. Because he said to me, he goes, Cammy, you have three words that means I love you. How many times a day do you get asked to say that? I don't know, maybe once or twice a week, I don't know. He goes, how about every 5 minutes? He said, if he drops his keys in public, if he's late for the elevator and the door's closed and somebody's there, if he's running in the airport and they close the gates, the flight attendant, you know what she's gonna say? He said, you don't understand. People say it to me and they think I'm hearing it for the first time. So don't be shocked or upset if you wander up and find Wally and ask him to say that and he doesn't say it.
Isn't Wally Shawn also in Maisel?
Yes, he is. He's in season 3, yeah. Yes, I know. Turns out there are a lot of Princess Bride fans out there. It's a wonderful
It's a wonderful All right, one more and then we'll get to the audience questions. Tell me something about Billy Crystal.
Billy? Yes. How great is Billy? I've been such a big fan from Soap and Sapphire that I, when he arrived in October with Carol Kane to play Miracle Max in the Valley, I said to Rob, I said, oh, can I go and say hi? I want to say hi. I'm so excited. He said, yeah, he's in the makeup trailer. Go see him. So I went to the makeup trailer and I knock on the door and I go in. And there's Billy getting made up to play Miracle Max. And it's a long makeup thing to become, 200 years old. And, they put on all this latex rubber on his face, and all these wrinkles, and these giant eyebrows, and the wig, and these varicose veins on his hand. And he's got two photographs on the mirror in front of him. And one is of an old lady, and one is of an older guy. And I said, Billy, what's with the pictures? And he goes, that's going to be Miracle Max, those two people. And I said, well, who are they? He goes, that's my grandmother, and that is Casey Stengel, the Yankees manager. And if you look at Casey, you can kind of see it. Anyway, so now, as he's getting into makeup, he starts getting into character, and he starts hacking like this. He starts talking like Max, and he suddenly becomes Max. And I'm already dressed and ready to shoot the scene, because another easy scene for me. I'm mostly dead in this scene, too. I'm lying on the slab, just laying there. And Billy says, he turns to me and goes, I'm hungry. You want to get something to eat? And I said, absolutely. This I have to see. So we go to the studio commissary, which is a lot like a high school cafeteria, and we get our trays, and we walk down the line. He's still in character as Miracle Max. And he comes up to the lady working behind the camera and he goes, Mrs. The shepherd's pie is spicy. Like that. And she goes, not particularly, sir. And he goes, you don't know my colon. And he just like cracking jokes like that all day long. With ballet, with everything. We get to the set, and again, Rob says, why don't we just shoot the rehearsal? You guys know what you're doing. It's just shit. And he turns to me and he goes, Gary, when you're laying on the slab, you can't
breathe too much because we can see your chest moving. And you're supposed to be mostly dead.
I said, well, how long do you want me to hold my breath?
He says, don't worry, we won't get you. We won't get you.
And he walks over to Billy, and he whispered something in his ear. And I asked Rob, when I wrote this book that I wrote about the making of the film, I asked Rob, 30 years later, I go, Rob, by the way, what was it that day that you whispered in Billy's ear? I never forgot, 30 years later. I'm like, what did he say? And Rob goes, it's funny you asked me that. I said to him, just go for it. And I thought to myself, this guy's already in character. What's he gonna, you know, what can he possibly do? So Rob walks away from whispering in his ear and he yells action. And Billy launches into 2 hours of medieval Yiddish stand-up. None of it in the script, none of it. And there are kids here, so I can't repeat some of the stuff. And all Vikings and sheep and yeah. But anyway, very crazy, very silly, none of it written, I don't know where that footage is. But, of course, we were all laughing, right? So they removed me from the set, and they replaced me with the rubber dummy, the one that Fezzik is carrying around in the forest. So I'm now watching the scene with Rob, the monitor, and Rob has a really loud laugh, you know, it's a very boisterous loud laugh. You can hear it. If he was laughing now in LA, you could hear it now. And they made him leave the set, because his laugh was ruining the takes. What takes these were going to be used in what film, I have no idea. But they kept shooting, and all of it's somewhere on film. I don't know where it all is, but it's all, it was hilarious. That was our first day with him. And, oh my God, hilarious, just hilarious. Seven. Billy Crystal, amazing. Great stuff. All right.
Are these people who have waited patiently?
Yes.
They want to ask
Thank
questions.
You.
Hello,
what's your name?
Kathy. I remember seeing you working with a young child actress named Helena Bonham Carter in
yes.
Lake Jane.
Oh, wow. Mel came to see the first screening of Princess Bride, and he brought one of my, I still am a massive Mel Brooks, for me growing up, there were two three. There was Monty Python, right? If you're British, and you don't know Monty Python, you're not considered British at all. Mel Brooks, and I was introduced to Mel Brooks as a kid through Get Smart, right? Great show. And then obviously watched every single movie 100 million times, you know, producers, Young Frankenstein, Lazy South, the whole thing, right? And then, and Peter Sellers. Which one?
Spaceballs,
of course. Of course. And so, he came to the screening and brought Gene Wilder with him. Right? And I think this is what I said when Mel introduced me, he goes, hey, this is Gene. And I go, and they did the day by something like that. And he was very sweet, and I think he was used to people doing that when he met him. And I just thought this is the greatest screening ever. You know, hopefully Carl Ryan was there, Mel, Gene Wilder. It was a big deal for me, you know. And then I'm at home about a week later. I'm sitting at home, and the phone rings, and I pick it up, and the voice on the other end goes, hello, is this Gary? I go, yes. This is Mel Brooks. And I go, yeah, right. I thought it was one of my friends playing a prank on me. I mean, why the heck would Mel Brooks be? And the phone rings again, I pick it up, and he goes, don't hang up, it's really me. Saw the film, you were great, and I want you to come and talk to me
about maybe doing Robin Hood. Am I right? And I said, absolutely, I will do that. And I literally made an appointment with his office, and I was there the next day, and I said, he goes, do you want to read the script? I went, no, I'm good. I'm good to go. I know it's going to be great.
Was the English accent mine, yours?
I know. That was the line, obviously, that he had written. He'd seen the Kevin Costner film. That's funny, I ran into Kevin about a year after the movie came out. Kevin did this to me, he goes, it's very funny. We had a lot of fun. Every day was laughter with Mel. Every day. There wasn't one day. He'd come up to me after a take, in this one, you need to suck a little less. Things like that. So we were laughing all day. It was just silly. Silly. Just suck less.
Thank you very much. All right, let's go over to the side.
Hi, what's your name?
I told you earlier that I didn't see the Princess Bride until like I was in my 20s, and I'm 31 now. But
you drove all the way from Mississippi.
Yes,
right?
So that's correct.
So give it up for Samantha. All the
way. Well, actually, I drove to Chicago to meet you in August.
That's right.
And I live in Mississippi now. And
God bless you.
I didn't think you'd be here, so that's why I'm here. I read about
the book is for sale at my booth, by the way.
It's great. It's great. I'll vouch for it.
Thank you, Samantha.
But one of the things that I read about it was I didn't realize how much of a challenge it was to this movie made. Just
Andre's Fog was just a challenge.
And I love the stories about him, and I love your impression of him, by the way. That's one point. But what I want to know is, after all the things you guys have been through to make this movie, all the money, the time, the heart, everything you guys pulled together to make this movie, did you guys ever, in a million years, at that point in time, think it would be such a classic that it is now?
No. There's no way anyone could know that. I mean, honestly, I think the only people today that could probably stand up and say, yeah, we're going to make a lot of money and this film's going to be successful would be the head of Marvel Studios, right?
Right.
Because when you're making a film that isn't, you know, part of the Marvel Universe, you're out there gambling, pretty much. You know, it's a gamble making a film. And it's a, you know, you hope and pray. Nobody sets out to make a bad movie. I know you've seen some where you've gone, yeah, these guys clearly work hard. But everybody wants to make a good film or a good TV show, and everybody puts their heart and soul into it, and at least the people I've had the pleasure of working with do. And we all thought we had a pretty good shot at it, you know? I mean, we had Bill Goldman writing the screenplay, who's no slouch. He wrote a couple of little screenplays called All the President's Men, Marathon Man, and Butch Cassidy, and Sundance Kid. We're thinking, this is pretty cool, right? We had Rob Reiner, who just come off a little film called Spinal Tap. It's a pretty funny movie. We're thinking, that's 2 for 2 right there.
On a roll.
And we're thinking, and this cast, like I said, this great cast that I've met, Chris Sarandon, and Billy Crystal, and Wally Shawn, and all these great people. And by the way, it's a huge gamble on casting me. I mean, Robin was already on a soap opera called Santa Barbara, so she had a lot more experience than me. Rob had seen the film Kathy liked, Lady Jane, thank God, that I made a year earlier, and he saw the film and went, this is the guy we should talk to this time. So thank God he saw it, because otherwise it would have been Colin Firth.
Thank God.
God bless Colin Firth. But, you know, and so luckily it was me. Thank God. Thank God. So anyway, so we all thought it was going to be something, and of course the movie came out and it actually kind of went away. It was very sad. It didn't make a lot of money. It came out the same weekend as Fatal Attraction, which cleared everybody. And so Rob took us all to dinner in New York after the screening, and he said, look, you know, we understand the studio that's not going to make the kind of success that they hoped, but I want you all to know this film means a lot to me, and I will never forget the experience. sure enough, the film came out later on in this new medium called VHS. Thank you, whoever invented the VCR. Because all you lovely folks who ended up first renting the film and then lending it out to family and friends and then not letting it out to anyone, and holding on to it and then passing it down from generation to generation, that's where the movie suddenly had its legs. And this film that had been mostly dead for 10 years, I know I keep using that phrase, suddenly had life again. And I remember I was in New York, I was ordering a hamburger or something in a restaurant, and the waitress said, "How do you want that cooked?" And I said, "Medium rare." She went, "He went." I had a look before. I went, "Excuse me?" She went, she did this, she goes, "Yeah." And that was it. And I went, "Oh." So, yes, thank you to the inventor of the VCR. What's your name?
Hi, Carrie. My name is Casey.
Hi, Casey.
Tennessee.
Hi, Casey. You came all the way from Tennessee?
You betcha I did. Okay, so, The Princess Bride is a huge part of my childhood, right? As many of you are, I'm sure. So, my dad's middle name is Leslie.
For real?
For real. My brother's name is Leslie.
No.
And now my son's middle name is Leslie.
What?
So, as a child,
I all the child pirates. All of them. Not to ruin it for you.
Well, you kind of did. I was going to ask how many takes it took to get a perfect shot.
Yes, I'd already broken my toe on Andre the Giant's all-terrain vehicle, so Rob Ryan said, "No more stunts for you. That's it. We're good." Oh my God. Never get in a salt and pepper shake. Never. Don't do it.
Let's go over here.
Hi, what's your name?
Hi, I'm Kat.
Hi, Kat.
So you're a huge fan, but you're also in one of my favorite TV shows, Psych.
Yeah, no, a very silly show. I had, you know, when I got cast, I was cast at the last minute, and I said to the showrunner, I said, you know, I haven't watched the show that much, and still want to send you a bunch of tapes. This was back when I was at VCR. So they sent me a whole box of tapes, because the show had been on for a while. They said, you don't need to watch it all, just, you know, watch a few, you'll get a sense of the show. So I watched a few, but then I had to leave, literally, the next day to go up to Vancouver. So I only watched like 5 episodes or something. So I really wasn't as tuned in as I'd like to be, because normally when I start any project, I want to be up to speed. So I didn't get a chance to see it all. And I told the showrunner that when I got there. He said, "Don't worry, you know the role you're playing, it's gonna be fine." So I get to the set, and James and Dulé are there, and they're wonderful, really funny, lovely people, very silly, very silly. And we did a scene, and Dulé got scared, and his character gets scared in the scene. He did this girly scream that I didn't know about. And he goes, "Ah," like that, and I just burst out laughing. I'm like, "No way." And the director goes, "Cut." He goes, "No, that's how his character screams." And I thought, this is absurd. And that was like that all day long. We just had, and they got to improv a lot, the two of them. Their chemistry is amazing. And so they would improv a lot, and I would have to keep a straight face because I was playing a very serious character. But if you go back and watch all those scenes, you'll see I'm hiding a laugh. I'm just holding it in because these guys are just absurd. So again, they're paying me to have such a good time. It just makes no sense. It's so silly. We laugh all day long. Now, I think a lot of those outtakes are on. Yeah, so if you want to check out all of us being silly, really silly, you can go with it, I think. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. working with one of my childhood idols, a wonderful actor called Sir Michael Caine. Yes. Yes. And it's a film with Aubrey Plaza called Best Sellers. And yes, she's magnificent. And I learned a wonderful thing from Michael Caine while we were working. He said to me one day, he goes, "You know, they pay me to sit around. The rest I do for free." And I thought, that's brilliant. You know, because you hear about actors complaining, like, "Yeah, hey, what's taking so long?" You know, but really, that's true. You know, like I was saying to you, you know, it's crazy that they're paying you to have this much money. And that's his motto. That's his philosophy. They pay me to sit around. The rest I do for free. And he's brilliant. And he's in his mid-80s now. And he's, I mean, never missed a take, never missed a cue, nothing. And I thought to myself, my God, it was everything I hoped for working with him. He was just so funny and gracious and brilliant. And I'm going to post a picture later so you'll see it. You can see on my face, I'm just like, this is nuts. How the heck did I get to be here, you know? Yeah, very special. Thank you.
So, my name is Bethany, I'm from New Orleans.
Are you dressed?
So,
oh my gosh, look at you, Bethany. Show everybody. Come on up here. Come on. You've made the effort, you should show it off. Come on, show it off. Well done. Give it up for Bethany. Magnificent. What is it?
Sorry, my friend.
It's your good seeing you guys. Thank you very much.
That is awesome.
Wonderful.
I'm always, as you know, ready to do Monty Python scares. All day long. That was fantastic. Thank you.
Hello, what's your name? Which is crazy when you think about it, because, and I think that you